السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. In our last session, we covered the tafsir of the sixth ayah of Surah Yusuf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or Yusuf alayhi salatu wa sallam, and says, وَكَذَلِكَ يَجْتَبِيكَ رَبُّكَ وَيُعَلِّمُكَ مِنْ تَأْوِيلِ الْأَحَادِيثِ وَيُتِمُّ نِعْمَتَهُ عَلَيْكَ وَعَلَى آلِ يَعْقُوبَ كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَى أَبَوَيْكَ مِنْ قَبْلِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْحَاقَ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. And in this manner, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will select you and He will teach you the interpretation of events. And He will perfect His blessings upon you and upon the family of Ya'qub, كَمَا أَتَمَّهَا عَلَى أَبَوَيْكَ, as He perfected these blessings upon your forefathers before this, Ibrahim and Ishaq. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. Verily your Lord is all knowledgeable and all wise. Today, inshallah, we'll move on to the next few ayahs, starting from ayah number 7. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفُ وَإِخْوَتِهِ آيَاتٌ لِلسَّائِلِينَ. Indeed, in Yusuf and his brothers are signs, ayats, for those who ask. So the ayah begins with the word لَقَدْ. And لَقَدْ is used for emphasis. قَدْ is used for emphasis, and لَام is also used for emphasis. If the لَام has an alif, then it gives the exact opposite meaning. It comes for negation. لَا means no. Like لَا إِلَهَ, there is no God except Allah. But when it comes without the alif, with لَا, then it comes for affirmation. It comes for emphasis and ta'kid. So لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفْ. Indeed, in Yusuf, meaning in the story of Yusuf, وَإِخْوَتِهِ, and his brothers, آيَاتٌ, are signs لِلسَّائِلِينَ, for those who ask. And we mentioned before, آيَات is the plural of the word آيَة. And آيَة has few meanings. And one of the meanings is indication or a lesson. So in the story of Yusuf and his brothers are signs and indications for those who ask. And scholars have mentioned that in this story, primarily there are three different types of indications. The first one is that it indicates towards the power and the qudrat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It indicates toward the majesty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps those who are in need, how He helps those who are in distress, and how, in a miraculous way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevates the status of His servants. And we see this many, many examples in the surah. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam from the bottom of the well in Canaan and brought him to the most beautiful and highest of the palaces in Egypt. So in this is an indication of the qudrat and the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second one is that in it are indications of the lessons and morals that we find in this surah. And there's many, many lessons that we learn. And inshallah, as we read every ayah and we give the explanation, inshallah, we'll cover them one by one. And finally, there's also an indication towards the truthfulness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We mentioned in the beginning of the surah, when we were giving the introduction, that some of the Quraysh, they went to Medina and they asked the Yahud of Yathrib, and they asked him that, give us a trick question whereby we can test Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and know whereby he is a true messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. So they said, ask him about the story of Yusuf and his brothers. If he's able to answer this question, then indeed he's a prophet and messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we mentioned the reason why they chose this question. Because the Yahud, they were from the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Arabs, they were from the lineage of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. And Yusuf is from the lineage of Ishaq. So the Arabs, they did not have much to do with Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and they probably never even heard of this story. So they said, if he is really a prophet and messenger of Allah, and if he really receives revelation and inspiration from Allah, he should be able to answer this question. So they went back with this question, and they posed this question before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Tell us about Yusuf and his brothers. And immediately, this whole surah in its entirety was revealed to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So in it, there is a sign and indication towards the truthfulness of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لَقَدَ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفْ وَإِخْوَتِهِ آيَاتٌ لِلسَّائِلِينَ. Indeed, in the story of Yusuf and his brothers are signs for those who ask. Now this is the only place in the Quran where the word sa'ilin is used. That in this are signs for those who ask. Generally speaking, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He ends an ayah, He says, إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمِ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. In this there's a sign for those who ponder. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ. In this is a sign for those who use their intellect. إِنَّ فِي ذَٰلِكَ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمِ يَتَذَكَّرُونَ. In this is an ayah for those who take heed. But this is the only place where the word sa'ilin is used. For those who ask. asking is the least form of inquisitiveness. You know, higher than this is to ponder, to think, to contemplate. But the least form of inquisitiveness is to ask. In other words, you don't have to be a magnificent, grandiose scholar in order to benefit from this surah. Even a lay person, someone who just is inquisitive and would like to ask, inshallah, he'll be able to benefit from this surah. Because the message is very clear and very simple. Even by just simply reading your translation and hearing the tafsir, you'll be able to benefit from it. You don't have to have in-depth knowledge of tafsir. The morals and lessons manifest in this surah are very clear and very simple. So this is the only place where the word sa'ilin is used. And this tells us that asking is something of benefit. Generally speaking, asking has been encouraged in Islam. In the Quran, we see that there's many, many ayahs that talks about, that says, yas'alunak. The Quran is full of yas'alunaka, they ask you. Yas'alunaka an al-ahilla, they ask you concerning the crescent. Yas'alunaka an al-shahr al-haram, they ask you concerning the sacred months. Yas'alunaka ma'adha yunfiqoon, they ask you what should they spend. Yas'alunaka an al-khamr wal-maisir, they ask you concerning wine and gambling. Yas'alunaka an al-jibal, they ask you concerning the mountains. Yas'alunaka an dhul-qarnayn, they ask you about dhul-qarnayn. Yas'alunaka an al-sa'a, so on and so forth. There's so many yas'alunaka in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers many of these yas'alunaka. Also Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith he said that innama shifa'u al-'ayyi as-su'al, the cure to ignorance is asking questions. Once Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he sent a delegation. He sent some of the sahaba on an expedition. And one of the sahabi, one of the companions, he got injured. He received a head injury. And then he went to sleep, and when he woke up, he was in a state of janabat, which means he had to take ghusl. So then he asked, he said, is there any rukhsa, is there any concession for me? Then instead of me taking ghusl, if I can do tayammum. So one of them, he said, no, you have to do ghusl. We don't see any rukhsa for you. You know, this is what I think, this is my opinion. Just like nowadays, many people, they say, I think this is what Islam means, I think this is what the hadith means, this is my opinion. Okay, and in Islam, there's no such thing as my opinion, it's based on Quran and hadith. So this is what the person said, and so that person who was injured, he actually took a shower, it was very, very cold, and because of it, since his wound was not healed, it affected him, and he actually died because of it. When they came back to Medina and reported this incident to the Prophet ﷺ, he was very, very upset. And in fact, some of the words he used were very, very harsh. He said, قَتَلُوهُ قَاتَلَهُمُ اللَّهُ, they were the ones who killed him, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse them. إِنَّمَا شِفَاءُ الْعَيَّ السُّؤَالِ, why did they not ask a person of knowledge? For verily, the cure to ignorance is asking. Okay? So it is very, very important that we ask. In another hadith, Rasulullah ﷺ said, حُسْنُ السُّؤَالِ نِصْفُ الْعِلْمِ, asking good questions is half of this deen, half of this religion. Okay, but the condition is asking good questions, okay? Not just asking anything, you know. And I also have to mention that sometimes, you know, going to the other extremes is also encouraged, discouraged. When you start asking, you know, about things that are irrelevant, that doesn't really pertain to you, and you start asking about details that doesn't directly pertain to you, and you're just asking just for the sake of asking, that is also something that is discouraged. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that in the Quran too. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tas'alu an ashya in tubda lakum tasu'ukum. O you who believe, do not ask about those things, that when the answer is given, it would then grieve you. Okay? The typical example is of Bani Israel, when they were ordered to slaughter a cow. Right? The order they were given was very simple and straightforward. Inna Allah ya'murukum an tadhbahu baqara. Allah orders you that you slaughter a cow. Baqara is nakira. It's indefinite. It's not you have to specific al-baqara, a specific cow. Just slaughter any cow. And they said, ask Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, they said, قَالُ دُعُ لَنَا رَبَّكِ يُبَيِّن لَنَا مَا هِيَ. You know, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask your Lord so that he can explain to us exactly what this is. We want more details. So he said, okay, إِنَّهَا بَقَرَةٌ لَا فَارِدٌ وَلَا بِكْرٌ. It's neither too old nor too young. عَوَانٌ بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ, between the two. So فَفْعَلُوا مَا تُؤْمَرُونَ, now do what you have been commanded. Still, they were not satisfied, so they asked him more questions. قَالَ دُعُ لَنَا رَبَّكِ يُبَيِّن لَنَا مَا لَوْنُهَا. Ask your Lord so he can clarify to us the color of this cow. So إِنَّهَا بَقَرَةٌ صَفْرَاءُ فَاقِعُ لَوْنُهَا. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it is a cow of a specific color, yellow, bright in color, and it pleases the onlookers. Still, they were not satisfied, so they asked more questions. And the more questions they asked, the more they made it difficult upon themselves. Because remember, the more questions they ask, the more specific it becomes. And now they have to, you know, find that particular cow which is neither too old nor too young, which has a specific color, which is very bright, and so on. It has to fulfill all of these conditions. So this is why when you ask too many questions, you make it difficult upon yourself. Now we understand that hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when Hajj became farad, and he told everyone, Ya ayyuhan nas qad furida alaykum al-hajju fahujju. Hajj has become obligatory on you, now you should perform Hajj. So someone asked, Ya Rasulullah, akulla amin? Every single year? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam remained silent. And then he asked again, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Law qultu na'am la wajabat. If I were to say yes, it will become farad and wajib, wala mastata'tum, and you will never be able to do so. And he said, إِنَّمَا هَلَكَ مَنْ كَانَ قَبْلَكُمْ بِكَثْرَةِ سُؤَالِهِمْ. Those who came before you were destroyed because of asking too many questions. So just leave me with whatever I leave you with. Okay? إِذَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. When I ordered you with something, do it to the best of your ability as much as you can. وَإِذَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ شَيْءٍ فَدَعُوهُ. And when I forbid you from something, refrain from it completely. Just, it's that simple. Don't go into asking too many questions. So when it comes to details and things that doesn't pertain to you, then it is discouraged. Another example I'll give, which is, I think, a little bit easier to understand, is that once the student of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, he came to her, and he started asking about these details, vague matters, that doesn't really pertain to him. So Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha asked him, said, have you perfected your salah? Have you perfected your tahajjud? Have you perfected your ibadah? And he started giving 101 excuses, just like many of us. So then she said, do not, you know, don't increase the evidence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala against you then. Okay? First, worry about things that pertain to you, things that are more important and relevant. Worry about that before you go into things that are vague and that doesn't really concern you. So again, asking good questions, it is half of religion, but the condition is it has to be husnus wal, good questions, not irrelevant things. Okay? And I'll just, on a lighter note, just mention a story. Once, it is said in the time of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah, you know, in his gathering, he was discussing some fiqh matters. You know, they used to discuss, and people used to ask questions, and he used to have many scholars. And it is said there was this one young man, he was also sitting, but he was not asking any questions. So he was curious. He said, you know, you always sit here, you never ask questions, you should always ask so that you can benefit, you know. He was always silent. He would never ask anything. So the next day he said, okay, I'll ask some questions then. So the next day, they were discussing about the fiqh of salah, you know, salatul asr, and, you know, when it ends, and about sunset, and, you know, all of the fiqh related issues regarding asr salah. You know, you have to make sure you pray your asr salah before the sunset, so on and so forth. So then he says, okay, I have a question. So he said, okay, now everyone is, curious. Okay, what is it that he has to ask? He never asked a question. He says, my question is, what if suppose the sun doesn't set? Then what do you do in this case? So he said, okay, you know, in your case, it is better that what you were doing before, it's better that you do stay silent. So asking good questions is half of this deen. So, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي يُوسُفُ وَيْخُوَتِهِ آيَاتٌ لِلسَّائِلِينَ. Indeed, in the story of Yusuf and his brothers are signs for those who ask. The next ayah, ayah number 8. إِذْ قَالُوا لَيُوسُفُ أَخُوهُ أَحَبُّ إِلَىٰ أَبِينَا مِنَّا وَنَحْنُ عُصْبَةٌ إِنَّ أَبَانَا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. When they said, verily Yusuf and his brother are more beloved to our father than us, وَنَحْنُ عُصْبَةٌ, while we are a strong group. إِنَّ أَبَانَا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Verily our father is in plain error. The ayah begins with the phrase إِذْ, when they said. And this is generally how stories in the Quran begin, with id. We don't have the exact equivalent of this in English, but we have something similar. When we want to start a story in English, we say, once upon a time. So in Arabic, you have something similar, especially in the Quran, that when a story is being mentioned of the past, it begins with the phrase id, when they said. La Yusufu, lam is used for emphasis. As I just mentioned earlier, without the alif, it is used for emphasis. Yusuf, wa akhuhu, and his brother, are more beloved to our father than us. Even though all of them were brothers, but over here they're referring to the full brother of Yusuf, which was Benjamin. Okay? All the rest of the brothers, the 10 brothers, they were the stepbrothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. He had one full brother, Benjamin. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, as we mentioned before, had 4 wives, or actually, according to the Old Testament, 2 wives and 2 maidservants. Okay? And he had 2 sons from. And in the name that they give in the Old Testament of the mother of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is Rachel. That's the name that's mentioned in the Old Testament. Wallahu alam, how it is pronounced in Hebrew or even in Arabic. And then she passed away, and then Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam married his sister. That was the khala, okay, of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And later on, when the mother prostrates before Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, that is actually the stepmother, okay, or the maternal aunt. And Rasulullah said, Al-khalatu bi manzilatil umm. The maternal aunt is in the place of the mother. His name was Binyamin, okay, the full brother of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. His name was Binyamin, and we have the English version of it, which is Benjamin. Benjamin comes from Binyamin. Bin means the son of, and Yamin in Arabic means the right hand. And in Hebrew, Yamin means one of power. That is one meaning. Another meaning some have said is that it means a person who is born in pain and in anguish. Because when he was born, his mother passed away. His mother passed away in childbirth. So as soon as Binyamin was born, the mother of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, she passed away. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam had four wives, okay? And again, many people always raise these questions, you know, that in Islam, how come this is allowed? Where all of this concept of polygamy was there since time immemorial. It is actually the Quran which restricts it to four. If you look in the Old Testament, almost every single prophet and every single king of the Old Testament had more than one wife. And many people say that, okay, if a person has more than one wife, then the children born from the second wife, they're illegitimate children. You know, but how could this be true? And how could people claim this, make this kind of claim? We know, for example, Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam were prophets of Allah. They had more than one wife. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam had more than one wife. And all of these children, na'udhu billah, we don't say that they were illegitimate. In fact, we say that they were the children of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam and Bani Israel, and they were the chosen people of their time. Because Allah says in the Quran, Ya Bani Israel, adhkuru ni'mati allati an'amtu alaykum wa anni faddaltukum ala al-alamin. I have chosen you over the rest of mankind. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam also had more than one wife. Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, according to the Old Testament, had hundreds of wives. Okay, it was actually the Quran that restricted it only to four. So anyway, I just wanted to mention this point that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, his real brother was, full brother was Binyamin. So they said, Yusuf and his brother, they are more beloved to a father than us. Wa nahnu usba, while we are a strong group. The word usba is used for a group of people anywhere from 5 to 10, and they were 10 in number. One word translation of usba would be like a gang. But a gang has a negative meaning to it. It means a strong group. So they're saying we're a strong group, we're older, we're, you know, we're stronger, we're help our dad, we're the majority. Where Yusuf is very young. Perhaps maybe he was 7 years of age, and Binyamin was very young at that age. He was probably wasn't even able to speak yet. So they can't do anything. We're the ones who take care of all the household needs. We take out the animals, we graze the animals, you know, we bring food, provide the family with, you know, food and so on and so forth. So we are a strong group. وَنَحْنُ عُصْبَ إِنَّ أَبَانَا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Verily our father is in plain error. Now dalal over here is not in reference to religion, okay? Because if you're to consider a prophet of Allah as dalal in a religious sense, then that person will be out of the fold of Islam. He cannot be a Muslim. What they meant is that he's dalal in a worldly sense. He has made a mistake. How could he love Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam more than us when we're the ones who take care of all of the household needs? We're older, we're stronger, we're the majority, and they're just only two, and they're just too young to do anything. So إِنَّ أَبَانَا لَفِي ضَلَالٍ مُبِينٍ. Verily our father, he is in plain error. Now notice, the only thing they can accuse Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam is loving Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam more. And they saw that from the way he looks at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, looking at him, with a tender heart. That's the only thing. Otherwise, they cannot accuse Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam of giving more to the to Binyamin or to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. In other words, they cannot accuse him of giving them more material blessings. Because in our Sharia, the father is supposed to treat all of the children equally when it comes to material blessings and physical blessings. Once a person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I want you to bear witness to this fact that I'm giving my son a gift. Okay? And I would like you to be witness to this. And the gift that he was giving was a servant. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, have you given all of your children the same gift? And he said, no. He said, then do you want all of your children to treat you equally and the same? And he said, yes. He said, then in that case, don't do this. Okay? اتقوا الله وعدلوا في وعدلوا في أولادكم. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and be just among your children. So when it comes to material blessings, the father has to be fair. He has to treat all of them equally. However, when it comes to love, that is something of the heart and is not in his control. And for this reason, a person will not be held accountable for it. So when it came to physical blessings and material blessings, he was treating all of them equally. That's why they could not accuse him of this. The only thing they could accuse him was that he loves Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam more than us, and love is something of the heart, and a person will not be held accountable for it. The next ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, they said, اقتلوا يوسف أو اترحوه أرضا يخل لكم وجه أبيكم وتكونوا من بعده قوما صالحين. They said, kill Yusuf أو اترحوه, or throw him أرضا, into a land. Okay, أرضا means any land, an unknown piece of land. يَخْلُ لَكُمْ وَجْهُ أَبِيكُمْ, the face of your father will become solely for you. وَتَكُونُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ قَوْمٌ صَالِحِينَ, and after that you can become righteous people. This tells us few things. Number one, the dangers of jealousy. And we talked about this before, and this is a common theme that occurs throughout the surah. Just because of that extra love Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam had for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, now the brothers of Yusuf are now willing to, they're even contemplating of killing him, and eventually they throw him into the well. When a person is jealous, it makes him do things that are completely ridiculous and insane. Just because of that extra love, they're planning to now even murder Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And Rasulullah said in a hadith, إِيَّاكُمَ الْحَسَدْ فَإِنَّ الْحَسَدَ أَكُلُ الْحَسَنَاتِ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ النَّارُ الْحَطَمُ. Beware of jealousy, because it eats up your good deeds just the way fire eats up dry twigs. In another hadith, Rasulullah called it الْحَالِقَ, the shaver. And he says, it doesn't shave off hair from your body, but shaves off iman from your heart. And what's really sad is that the brothers, they were not jealous of something, they were jealous of something that is actually noble. They wanted the love of their father, but the means that they were trying to get this was wrong. So therefore, you cannot acquire good through a means that is haram. You can never gain halal through haram. Okay, so they thought that if they kill Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, they will get the attention of their father. But did that even materialize? Did even that come true? Okay, no, they were not able to achieve their goals either. What happened? Instead of them gaining the attention of their father, the exact opposite happened. Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam started mentioning Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam even more than before, and because of his love for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he became blind. And what was his attitude towards the other sons? وَتَوَلَّى عَنْهُمْ, and he turned away from them. وَقَالَ يَا أَسَفَ عَلَى يُوسُفَ وَبْيَضَّتْ عَيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْحُزْنِ فَهُوَ كَذِيمٌ. He became blind and he continuously started remembering Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam more than ever before. Now, what was the were the ages of the brothers when they were trying to kill Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam? Now, majority of the scholars said that they were most likely adults, okay? They could not have been young children. But some of them, they said, no, perhaps they were children. And this is something strange and something very unique. And the reason why they said this is because they have to get out of a problem. Some of those commentators, they have said that eventually these brothers, they became prophets. And this is not the opinion of the majority of the scholars, and we mentioned this before. But some of them felt that perhaps they did become prophets, because Allah says in the Quran, you know, believe in Ibrahim and Ismail and Ishaq Yaqub, wal asbat, and the descendants of Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. And we also know later on, of the 10 brothers, the oldest one, what does he say at the end of the story when Benjamin is detained? He doesn't want to go with the rest of the brothers. And he says, فَلَنْ أَبْرَحَ الْأَرْضَ حَتَّى يَأْذَنَ لِي أَبِي أَوْ يَحْكُمَ اللَّهُ لِي. I will not move from the spot until either my dad gives me permission or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals something concerning me. So based on this and other ayahs, they felt that perhaps they became prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I mentioned that this was not the stronger opinion, and the majority say otherwise. But anyway, since they felt that they were prophets of Allah, then they have to get out of this problem. That how could a prophet of Allah do something like this, kill a person? So they say, well, perhaps maybe they were very young. Okay? They were very young. And obviously when you do something before you reach the age of maturity, then you are not held accountable for it. But the question is that if all of them had not reached the age of maturity, and say the oldest one was about, you know, 12 years old or 13 years old, that means the youngest one had to be about 2 or 3 years of age. Unless we say all of them were born as twins, okay? Otherwise, the math doesn't really work out, okay? And even if they were born as twins, say they're 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 years of age, How could children of this age actually plan to kill Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and take him to a well and lure him into the well? And especially when Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam says, I fear that a wolf might devour him, because Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is very young. And he was maybe 6 or 7 years of age. So if Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is that young that the father fears that the wolf might devour him, that means the brothers had to be older than that. They could have not been 4 or 5. And how could they actually lure Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam into the well? So it doesn't really work out. It doesn't really make sense. No, they were older, maybe 15, 16, anywhere from, wallahu alam, anywhere from 15 to 25, anywhere between that. And they did this. And one of the proof is that later on at the end, they said, oh, our father, forgive, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us. Which means they did make the mistake. This is why they had to ask for forgiveness. So no doubt they were older. And the stronger opinion is that they were not prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but they repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted their repentance. Now, one of the things they said was that, let's do this, and after it, we'll become righteous people. And this is one of the tricks of shaitan. He tells you that, okay, do this, and you make up for it later on. Innal hasanati yudhibna sayyiat, good deeds, it wash away your bad deeds. So you pray, mashallah, salah, you give zakat, you perform hajj, you're just doing one thing. Who cares? You know, just do this, and later on you can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. This is the trick of shaitan, and you're not the first person he's using this trick against. He used it against the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. However, some scholars have mentioned a very deep point. They said, although this is a trick of shaitan, and anything like this happens, know this is a waswasa of shaitan. But still, despite this, this kind of attitude is still better than the person who has no regret whatsoever. In other words, to regret what you're doing before you do the action is still better than the person who doesn't have any regret whatsoever. Okay? So when you're doing something and you know that what you're doing is wrong, and you realize it's a mistake, this frame of mind is still better than the person who doesn't even consider it as a sin. And he justifies his actions, and it's perfectly fine. Because when you justify an action, right, and you justify your sin, you will never have the opportunity to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because you don't consider yourself to be making a mistake. And the first step of repentance is that you have to have regret and remorse in your heart, and not a tawbah. Okay, the essence of tawbah is to have regret in your heart. How can you have remorse in your heart when you don't feel you have done anything wrong? So that's why always remember, if you're doing something wrong, consider it as a weakness, okay? Your weakness, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive you. Otherwise, if you think that what you're doing is right, you will never have the opportunity to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then finally, we end with the last ayah. They said, قَالَ قَائِلٌ مِّنْهُمْ لَا تَقْتُلُوا يُوسُفْ وَأَلْقُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْهِ يَلْتَقِطْهُ بَعْدُ السَّيَّارَةِ إِن كُنْتُمْ فَاعِلِينَ. One of them said, do not kill Yusuf. وَأَلْقُوهُ, and throw him, فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْهِ, into the bottom of the well. يَلْتَقِطْهُ بَعْدُ السَّيَّارَةِ, some travelers will pick him up, إِن كُنْتُمْ فَاعِلِينَ, if you're really going to do this. So it is said of the 10 brothers, most likely the oldest one, this is what many of the Mufassirin say, who had, you know, a soft spot in his heart for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, okay, if you're going to do this, you know, don't kill him, but rather, أَلْقُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْ, throw him into غَيَاب. غَيَاب comes from the word غَيْب. غَيْب means unseen. So all the bottom of the well, where you can't see and it's completely dark, that is called غَيْب. So the bottom of the well. Al-Jub means a well which is not well constructed, okay? Which is very primitive. A well that is well constructed is called Al-Bi'r in Arabic. Okay, Al-Jub means it is not well constructed. How does this benefit the story? Well, this means that they were not using a well which was frequented by the people of the city, but rather they were taking him to a faraway place which was used only by travelers. So they were hoping that some travelers will come and they will pick Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. وَأَلْقُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْهِ يَلْتَقِطْهُ بَعْدُ السَّيَّارَةِ. Some travelers would pick him up, إِن كُنْتُمْ فَاعِلِينَ, if you're really going to do this. So basically he says, if you're going to do this and there's no way out of it, just use this option. Okay? And there's an usul in fiqh, and that is called أَهْوَنُ الْبَلِيَّتَيْنِ, taking the lesser of the two evils. When you have two options and both of them are kind of negative, you take the lesser of the two evils. And this is what the older brother does. Actually, in some reports, it is said that he tried to stop them, but they said to him that if you don't stop, your fate is going to be the same as that of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay? And they also threatened him as well. So therefore, he said, if you're going to do this, then just throw him into a well and some travelers will pick him up. And from this, we learned this usul that you should take the lesser of the two evils. When you have two negatives, you know, you take the lesser of that. And just to kind of give an example, and again, not to become too controversial, but you know, people ask about, you know, voting, is this allowed or not, right? And there's two different opinions of scholars. One opinion is that, and this is also the position taken by many Christians as well, and especially the Jehovah Witnesses. They don't like to vote because it's, how can we vote for someone whom we know that is going to endorse and, you know, he's going to advocate something that goes against our belief. So that's why they never vote. And this, but within Islam, there's actually two positions of scholars. One position is this, and again, I'm not endorsing any view, but I'm just telling you this, just so that I explain the example of Ahwan al-Baliyatin, taking the lesser of the two evils. So some say we cannot obviously vote because we're going to be advocating and we're going to be endorsing someone who's going to be saying something that is going to be going against our belief, because no politician is perfect, right? And obviously, they don't always 100%, you know, go with what they say. You know, there's a joke. That once, you know, this is a strange joke, but anyway, I found it kind of funny, so I just related and shared it with you, that there was a group of politicians and they were in a bus, and all of a sudden it got crashed, and it was and it crashed on a farm. So the farmer, he came and he saw them, so he thought all of them were dead, so he buried all of them, and then he reports the incident to the police. He said, okay, this is what happened, these were politicians in the bus, and I buried all of them. He said, all of them were dead? He said, yes, there were some of them that were speaking, they were telling me they're still alive, but you know how you can't really believe the politicians, so I just buried them anyway. Okay? So they're not, you know, you don't really, so whatever they say, they don't always 100% go with what they say. So that's why, this is what some of the scholars say. Others say, other scholars of Islam, you know, because Islam is more practical, so it's not as strict as what some of the Christians say. They say that, yes, perhaps they may say things that go against our conscience and our belief, especially when it comes to, you know, like, you know, same-sex marriage, right? Christian, Jews, Muslims, we know we're obviously opposed to this idea. We believe marriage should only be between man and woman. So how can we endorse someone who endorses this kind of view and it goes against our belief? But then some of the scholars say, they try to apply this rule, أَهْوَنِ الْبَلِيَتِينَ, that no matter what you do, someone is going to take that position, okay? Whether you vote or not, someone is going to take that position. So if someone is going to endorse 10 things that goes against your belief system, and another one is going to say things, two things that goes against your belief system, you want to take the lesser of the two, and that is the principle that they use. And again, it's not that I'm endorsing any view, just wanted to kind of mention both views, and this is the proof that they use. Inshallah, we'll conclude with this, and we'll start with ayah number 10 next week, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wana, alhamdulillah, rabbil alamin.